Hello everyone, welcome back to the world of English exams. Have you seen the title of today's video? Yes, so it is particularly helpful for those candidates who are planning to take their IELTS academic test, and this is going to refer to task 1 of the writing test. So as you are aware, task 1 in the writing test is different based on the module. If you are taking the general training test, then you have to write a letter, while for the academic writing test, the candidates have to prepare to write a report based on several kinds of illustrations. So that is what we are going to cover today. Basically, this video is only for academic module. So without any further delay, let's get started by overviewing the IELTS test in terms of the modules, and we will quickly begin the report writing. So basically, the IELTS test is divided into two modules: academic, which is meant for the purpose of education, and general training, which is generally taken for the purpose of immigration. So there are two tasks in the writing test: task 1 and task 2. As I told you, task 1 is different, which is a report in the case of academic test and letter in the case of the general training test. Task 2 is the same, which is an essay, although the question is different. So you will be given around 20 minutes of time to finish the task 1 and around 40 minutes of time to complete the task 2. However, the time division is entirely your choice. So I have seen some candidates who complete their report within just 15 minutes because they are well aware of what to write and how to write, and they are very much clear about the structure. So since there is no confusion in these aspects, report writing is a very simple task. And essay writing, on the other hand, is a difficult task for some students, and some students find it very easy. They can complete the essay within just half an hour and focus more on task 1. So it depends on the candidate's perspective. And of course, the whole test has to be finished within 60 minutes of time. Unlike the listening test, where you get 10 minutes of time to transfer the answers, you don't get any such time in the writing test. So make sure that you're practicing in such a way that you're going to finish the whole test within a set time of 60 minutes. I would suggest that you make it to 50 to 55 minutes so as to be on the safer side. So one more important point about the academic test is the word count. Write at least 150 words. This is what you will see in the instructions for task 1. So don't just aim to hit that 150 word count. Always be on the safer side and aim for a word count between 160 and 190 words. Of course, there is no upper limit for this, but I would say that if you go on writing beyond 200 words, sometimes you might repeat the same words or ideas, and this could be one of the factors for penalty. So we don't want to receive any penalty on the band scores. Hence, we don't want to take a risk by writing too much. So having said that, let's quickly begin our understanding of task 1 academic, in which you will see the following types of illustrations in your test. So I'm not telling that all the types of illustrations will be seen. You might get either one or two. So let's examine them. The first one is the bar chart. Second one is pie charts. Then we have line graphs, maps, tables, flow charts, which are also known as process diagrams. Then we have a real diagram and some combinations sometimes. So what do I mean by combinations is, you might get a similar combination, that is two bar charts, two pie charts, maybe two line graphs, two maps, two tables, like that. So you can get the same type of illustration in a different way, two different types. So sometimes you might get a combination of various types of illustrations, like bar charts plus pie charts. Then you may get line graphs plus pie charts, like that. So understanding the format of writing a report is very, very essential when you are targeting a high band score. When I say high, it means band 7 or above. So the basic structure more or less remains the same, but the kind of representation you get will decide how to write a report based on that. So that is the intention of this video. And I intend to cover all these types of illustrations. So stay tuned till the end of the video. Let's get started with the first kind of illustration, which is maps. A very, very frequently given question in the writing test for academic is this. So basically, as you can see, here we have two maps. Both the maps are showing us the layout of something called Grang Park, but the point to observe here is that one map is showing us the layout of 1920 and the second one is the current layout, that is today. So how the Grang Park used to look and how it is developed round. So basically, when you see that there is a change in the time, you have to write the report in different tenses. That is, you have to use the past tense as well as the present tense in this scenario. Sometimes you may get a map which shows the present layout and the proposed development for the future. So depending on this feature, you have to write a report specifically. Remember that grammatical range and accuracy is one of the factors that will give you 25% of the score. So please don't neglect these small aspects. They will have a huge impact on your score. So when you are describing such a map, I'm now going to show you what is the basic structure that you need to follow. So the report would usually start with an introduction in which you're just going to paraphrase the given title. So what could be the paraphrase for this? Maybe you can write that the given maps show the layout of Grang Park in 1920 as well as how it looks today. That's it. We need not give any information in the introduction excepting the paraphrase statement. Now, the second paragraph we have to write is the overview. This is the most important paragraph in a report. Please do not skip this. The overview could be written after the introduction or after the body paragraphs. But if you ask me, I would ask you to write the overview after the introduction itself, because lack of overview will lead to a band 5 for report writing, whereas a clear overview will give you band 7. So you will have a drastic effect of not writing the overview. Hence, it is always better to write it after the introduction. So basically, you have to start this paragraph with the term overall and then describe the significant changes that you see. So before writing the overview, just take 1 or 2 minutes to highlight those features which are added or which are taken away from the first map to the second map. Let's just see. That here you can see that certain features like rose garden have remained the same, so they have not been altered, whereas the rose garden at this point has been moved to the central area, and the same thing happened with this also. The rose garden which is located at this point is now replaced by a cafe, and this rose garden is now shifted to the central region of the map. And also you can see that there is seating arrangement around the rose garden. Previously, seating arrangement was restricted to the corners, maybe boundaries, I can say. Here we have some seats, and here and on this side also we can see some seats. But in the current layout, the entire seating region is now shifted to the central area around the rose garden. So this is one significant development about which you have to indicate. Then one more thing I can see is the fountain is now replaced by the rose garden, and the stage for musicians has now been developed into an amphitheater for concerts. So previously there was just one stage, but now there is an amphitheater. So this is one development about which you have to talk about. Then we can also see that previously there was something called a glass house, and that is now being replaced by a water feature along with an entrance for the underground car park, which was not there previously. So previously we could only see two entrances, but in addition to those two entrances, we also have an entrance to the underground car park in the current layout. So these are the significant things that you have to see. And one more thing, the pond for water plants is now turned into a children's play area. So you can write that overall there are several developments made to the Grand Park, like addition of an amphitheater, changes in the seating arrangement and the position of the rose garden, along with replacement of glass house and pond for water plants with water feature and children's play area, along with the addition of an entrance to the underground car park. That is your overview. You are just summarizing the major developments that you see. Then coming to the body paragraphs, here I have indicated that you need to write the features. That means you have to describe about each and every feature in detail. When you are describing the body paragraph, the easiest and the most convenient approach is to talk about the park in 1920 in one paragraph and about the current layout in the second body paragraph. This avoids confusion and makes it much clearer for the reader to understand what you have written. So it also demonstrates your ability to use past tense and present tense separately. This is an additional point which will help you gain a better score in terms of bands. So this is how you have to write the structure of a map. If you observe, when we go ahead with the other kinds of illustrations, you will notice that the structure more or less remains the same. And one important tip here is to not give your opinion. Please do not state your opinion. Reserve your opinions for the essay. Do not give your opinions in the report. That is a blunder, actually. You should not be giving your opinion. Also, if you observe clearly, I have not indicated a conclusion. So it's not mandatory that you have to write a conclusion. If you want, you can just go ahead and write it. But I would suggest that the overview paragraph itself is like the conclusion, because we are summarizing the major aspects of the map. So there is no particular necessity to write the conclusion. However, it is your take on that. So let's proceed with the second type of illustration, which is pie charts. Pie charts are very frequently seen in the main test. So it is advised that all the candidates should practice enough number of pie charts in order to get a clarity about the language and the kind of vocabulary that you need to use. And one point remains constant, that is, tenses are very important. You have to look at the years if they are mentioned and then write it. However, in this particular pie chart, there is no mention about an year. Have you seen that the title just says average percentages of sodium, saturated fats and added sugars in typical meals consumed in the USA? So maybe it's talking about a pattern of how people in the US have consumed meals that contained these proportions of sodium, saturated fats and added sugars. So basically they are showing us four different meals here: breakfast, lunch, dinner and snacks. So that's why the pie is divided into the chart is divided into four regions. So basically when you're talking about a pie chart, you need to follow the same structure as previously indicated. That is, you have to write the introduction in which you paraphrase the statement. But in addition to that, there is another point that you can see here, which is units of measurement. There is a difference between a map and a pie chart in this respect. In the map, you are not able to see any units of measurement like percentages or centimeters or kilograms or nothing like that. But in a pie chart, clearly they are indicating that the units of measurement is percentage. So you have to indicate that in the introduction, that units are measured in percentages. The proportions are calculated in percentages, something like that. So unless you indicate that, the introduction will not be complete, and incomplete introductions will definitely receive a penalty. So please do indicate the units of measurement specifically when you're describing a pie chart. Not just a pie chart, even for other kinds of illustrations like bar charts, line graphs, or tables. So you will be having some units which you have to indicate in the introduction itself. So basically introduction contains two sentences. The first one is the paraphrase statement. And the second one is units of measurement. Write both these statements together in one paragraph. Then moving on to the next paragraph, which is the overview. There is a difference between the overview of a structural illustration like a map and a more functional kind of illustration like a pie chart. When you refer to this pie chart, you can see that in each and every pie chart, there is a highest proportion and there is a lowest proportion. Shall we just examine that, guys? Obviously, when I look at these two pie charts, I am able to see that this area, which is in black color, is dominant. What is it referring to? Dinner. So sodium as well as saturated fats are consumed in the highest proportions during dinner time, whereas when it comes to added sugars, its proportion is the highest during snack time. This is the important feature that you have to mention in the overview. In addition, you also have to talk about the least proportion. So the least proportion, the least percentage of sodium is consumed during snacks as well as breakfast. Whereas when it comes to saturated fats, the lowest proportion, the lowest percentage of saturated fats was consumed during breakfast. And added sugar also, the lowest proportion is consumed during breakfast. So that's it, guys. Don't get into the details. Don't indicate any percentages like 14%, 43%, 26%. Don't write any such statistics or numbers in the overview. This is one suggestion that I can give. Just talk about the trend that you see. So trend is nothing but what is the highest, what is the lowest, is there any constant value. If you can see this pie chart, the levels of sodium consumed are constant for both snack time as well as breakfast. So this is one constant or steady pattern that I am referring to in this. So like that, you just have to describe the major significant trends that you see in the pie chart when you are writing an overview. Whereas when it comes to the body paragraphs, you need to definitely describe the structures in more detail with the similarities and differences. Here, if you look at this, you have an option to write three body paragraphs. That is, one in one body paragraph you're going to talk about sodium, in the second one you're talking about saturated fat, and the third one you're talking about added sugars. So this makes it an easier way to write the body paragraph and structure it in a logical way. But you can take a call whether to write two body paragraphs or three body paragraphs. So with that, and again, I am not giving a conclusive paragraph here because it's optional. If you want, you may just write the conclusion, else please do not write it. However, don't write your opinion in this report too. That is a common instruction that I give for any kind of report. So now moving ahead with the third kind of illustration, which is line charts or line graphs. So you can see that in a line graph there are various lines which are showing us data represented for various segments, like this is referring to the goods transported in UK between 1974 and 2002. So that will be your paraphrase statement. The given line graph depicts the amount of goods transported in the UK using various modes like roadways, waterways, railways and through pipeline. That is it. Don't just go in detail. And is there any unit of measurement here? Absolutely. For that, you need to look at the y-axis. What is it? Million tons. You have to write that the units are measured in million tons, or the amount of goods transported is calculated in million tons. So this sentence is mandatory when writing the introduction. So similar to the pie chart, in the line graph also, you have to write a paraphrase along with units of measurement in the introduction. And when you're writing the overview paragraph, as I told you previously, you have to begin this paragraph with a linking word called overall. After you write the term overall, just look at the major trends. That is, obviously, it is clearly evident that this one is the most preferred mode of good transportation. What is that? It refers to roadway, road. So, you can write that the highest number of goods were transported using roadways throughout the period of study, or you can write from 1974 to 2002. You can also write that roadways have been the most preferred method of transporting goods in UK between 1974 and 2002, whereas this is the comparative word, contrasting word, whereas the least used mode of good transportation was the pipeline. That is it. Don't get into the details of describing the percentages in the overview. So, just the trends, that is increasing, decreasing, fluctuating, stable, highest, lowest, that's it. That is how you have to describe. And of course, in the body paragraph, you may target the similarities and the differences. All the similar features in one and the dissimilar features in the second. So, obviously, I can divide the body paragraphs like this. I can write about roadways and waterways in one body paragraph, and I can talk about railways and pipeline in the second body paragraph. Obviously, because these two are the top rated methods or the most used modes of transportation, whereas these two are not so preferred. So, based on that, I am going to design my body paragraphs. So, I hope you are getting an idea on how to write a report based on this. So, now let's progress to the next type of illustration, which is a bar chart. It is a very, very important thing for all the candidates to learn how to write bar charts, because we are able to see this type of illustration very, very commonly in the IELTS academic writing task 1. So, here this bar chart is showing us the data about UK telephone calls by category. There are three categories. What are they? Local or fixed line. Then we have national and international fixed line and mobiles, all calls between 1995 and 2002. So, obviously by looking at this, you have to understand that the report has to be written in the past tense only. You are not supposed to write the report in the present tense. That is one important thing that you have to remember. So, this bar chart can be described using three major segments. The first one is the introduction. In the introduction, you are going to paraphrase the title that you can talk about. You can write that the given bar chart illustrates the data about telephone calls made in the UK, which pertain to three categories called local or fixed line, national and international fixed line, and mobiles from the year 1995 to 2002. And what are the units of measurement? Again, you have to refer to the y-axis. So, units are measured in minutes, that is billion minutes. So, this is how you have to write the introduction, and followed by that is the overview paragraph. Again, you are going to notice the overall trend. You can see that the highest number of calls were made throughout the period. This line seems to be dominating throughout the period. It is the highest. What is it? Local and fixed line. So, you can write that the highest number of calls were made throughout the period of study by using local fixed line, while the least amount of calls or the lowest amount of calls were made using the mobile. This is how you have to write the overview. Don't go into the details. And when writing the body paragraphs, again, as I told you, you may compare the local line in one body paragraph, national and international in one, and mobiles in the other. Or you may also write about local fixed line in one and about the other two in the second body paragraph. It is up to you guys, but it is very important to use the past tense while describing it. Just bear that in mind, and you don't need to write a conclusion or an opinion. Then moving ahead with the next kind of illustration, which is table. Tables usually contain a lot of data which is compiled in the form of rows and columns. So it is important for us to use these words like this row, this particular column, the tabular form. So you use such kind of words to get a good impression in terms of vocabulary. Then many students often request me to tell them how to select the important points from a table. So let me show you that clearly, that when you're talking about a table, just blindly go and mark the highest value and the lowest value in each column and each row. That is point number one. That is, if you are referring to, let's say, this column of food, drinks and tobacco, the highest value is this and the lowest value I can see is this. I'm going to circle this. Then when it comes to clothing and footwear, the highest value is 9 and the lowest value I can see is 5.4. And when it comes to leisure and education, the highest value I'm able to see is this and the lowest value I'm able to see is this. Now I'll compare it row wise. When I talk about Ireland, the major expenses were made on food, drinks and tobacco, while the lowest expenses were made on leisure and education. When it comes to Italy, also the same thing. Highest proportion was made on this and the lowest proportion was made on leisure and education. When it comes to Spain, also the same trend. When it comes to Sweden, also it is the same, and Turkey also the same. Now I got a pattern that people in all these countries spent the most on food, drinks and tobacco, and I can see that the lowest amount was allocated towards leisure and education. Like this, you have to spend 1 or 2 minutes to understand the trend. Then it is very easy. So now when I'm writing the report, I'll start with the introduction, in which I just paraphrase the title along with specifying the units of measurement. So the paraphrase would look something like this. The given table depicts the data related to consumer spending. Instead of writing consumer expenditure, I'll write consumer spending on a national level in 3 categories like food, drinks and tobacco, clothing, footwear and leisure education in the year 2002. Very, very important, because you have to write the report in the past tense only. Then what are the units? Percentage. So the units are measured in percentages, or the amounts which are spent are calculated in percentages. Then this is the introduction. And what is the overview? As I told you, what is the category in which the consumer spent the highest, and you have to also indicate the consumer expenditure in the category of leisure and education, as it is the least. So you have to write both these things without indicating any numbers. Then in the body paragraphs, you can talk about country wise or you can talk about category wise. If you talk about country wise, then you will have to write 5 paragraphs, which is not at all recommended. You can go with category wise, maybe food, drinks and tobacco in one, and clothing and footwear in the second, leisure and education in the third. Otherwise, you also have an alternate and a much better way of writing the report. That is, all the highest values in one and all the lowest values in the other. So you just have to write 2 body paragraphs in this case, and it also improves your score as you are drawing comparisons between the different categories if you do so. So that is the approach which I suggest, but it is up to you. So that's why I have indicated all the highest values here and all the lowest values in the second body paragraph. So let's continue our understanding by looking at a flow chart. Flow chart is also called a process diagram. Here, basically, in some kinds of illustrations like maps, flow charts, life cycles, so you won't be having any units of measurement. So all you have to locate is what is the first stage and what is the final stage and how many steps are there, how do you represent them in a sequence. That's all you have to worry about. So when you see such a process diagram or a flow chart, you have to write the report with the paraphrase of the given question. So what is this process about will clearly be given in the question which you have to paraphrase. That's it. There are no units of measurement. And in the overview, talk about the main stages in the process. That is, what is the first stage and what is the last stage. And also you can talk about the total number of steps. So as you can clearly see, there are 10 steps in this process. So you will start the overview like this. Overall, there are 10 steps in this manufacturing process, which begins with raw material preparation and ends with customer support. That is it. We are not going to get into each and every step in detail in the overview. So, and when describing a flowchart, usually a process is something which will not change. So, it's better to use the present tense when talking about the process. Next, when you're talking about body paragraphs, you're going to describe each and every step in detail. You can see that there are some hidden features here about which you have to describe, and you have to also give the names of these steps. For example, here we have smelting, jet milling, compacting, something like that. So you have to give the name and describe each and every step in detail. Since there are 10 steps in the process, you can think of dividing it 5 steps in one paragraph and the rest of the 5 steps in the next body paragraph. That is a logical way of dividing the body paragraphs. So this is how you have to write a report based on a flowchart or a process diagram. Now let's move on to the next one, which is life cycle. So life cycle, there is a difference between a process and a life cycle. A process is a man-made thing. It is an artificial thing. It's not a natural process. It's not a natural thing which happens. Whereas life cycles are biological. They are natural. Hence, it happens in a cyclic way, whereas a process is always linear. Okay, so that is one thing that I have to tell you. And here also we don't have any units of measurement. Probably you may see that when the life cycle continues from one stage to another, you may be seeing that there are several time or now I can say that now these many days or these many weeks will be mentioned when you see the life cycle. That have to be indicated clearly. Other than that, you don't need to worry too much. It is more or less like the flowchart itself. Let's quickly look at the structure. So basically you have to start with the introduction, just paraphrase the question. What is it about? It's the life cycle of a frog. So that you can write that the given figure illustrates the stages in the life cycle of a frog. That's it. And in the overview, just like in the process, how many stages are there? Just write the first stage and the final stage. So how many stages are there? Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. 6 stages. So you can write that overall there are 6 stages, 6 major stages in the life cycle of a frog, which usually begin with the stage of egg laying, and the final stage is the development of an adult frog or a fully matured frog, and the life cycle will continue. So that is the overview. And in the body paragraphs, you have to write the stages in detail. Maybe you can talk about the first 3 stages, that is from egg laying to development of tadpole in one paragraph, and from tadpole with 2 legs to 4 legs to adult, you can talk about it in the second body paragraph. So this is how you describe the structure for various kinds of illustrations in the academic test. And please remember that sometimes combinations are also possible. So you have to practice each and every illustration in detail with the structure as shown here. So in this video, we have covered various types of illustrations, beginning with maps and then proceeding with pie charts, then line graphs. Then I have shown bar graphs, table, and then we progressed with flow chart and a life cycle. So with this, I will end the video. If you found this video useful, please do give it a big thumbs up, share it with your friends, and do subscribe to our channel, World of English Exams. And thank you so much for watching the video till the end. Your love and encouragement is helping us a lot in understanding what is useful for you and what kind of videos we have to come up with. So thank you so much and happy preparation, guys.